Okay, so our text will be coming out of Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. We're going to attempt to finish what we started last week in the search for significance. Amen. In Luke chapter 15 is a triology. It's the parable of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and today, the lost son. This parable has been given, most importantly, it's been given to publicans and sinners. So in Luke chapter 15, you'll have to find this for me. Luke chapter 15, we'll just begin reading in verse 1 and 2, that will let you have the seats. It says, "Then drew near unto him publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them." Amen. God bless you. You may have your seats. Last week, we were talking to you about the search for significance. We looked at what is called parables. Might say parables. Parables are just a simple story that Jesus gives that are profound kingdom truths that he has to bring to in contemporary thinking, so that way you would be able to understand really what he's talking about. He's talking to two groups of people, publicans and sinners. Publicans, we know who publicans are. Those were the tax collectors. Those were people who were detestable, people who did things that we really didn't like. They were greedy. They were ruthless, but they worked for the government. And because they worked for the government, they didn't care how hard your situation was. They would come to, as she said, they would come to take your place. Nobody liked them. Nobody liked to see them coming. And so there they were, and they're listening to Jesus teach. The other group of people, who we know who they are sinners, like us. And the third group of people were the Pharisees, people who were the religious right, the scribes, people who murmured and said, you know what, Jesus really shouldn't be talking to all of these sinners and publicans. We are the righteous ones. And Jesus knows who his audience is, talking to all three groups of people at the same time. And so he gives these kingdom truths. Imagine yourself being one of those publicans and sinners that you're here, you want to see another miracle, but Jesus stops in his tracks and he gives these teachings. And he says to these people who are publicans and sinners, people who are lost, people who don't have any hope left in their lives, at the same time he's talking to those people who are so snooty and uppity and bougie that they think that they are the religious right, and they are there to judge what Jesus is going to tell them. And so Jesus tells them a story about a man and a shepherd who lost his prime sheep. And he left the 99 and he went after the one. And he comes, he grabs that one, he finds him, he puts that one on his shoulders, and he says, "Everybody, rejoice with me, for that which was lost has now been found." And then he gives a second story about a woman. And the woman lost her precious coin. Last week we showed you how she swept diligently in her house. She lit a candle and she went around looking, because Jesus is trying to tell us that it's not really about just the woman losing the coin. It's about a person losing something of value in their lives. And so he says, you got to sweep diligently. You got to be careful. You got to shine a light. You got to make sure that you sweep it right until you find it, because some coins, they don't make a lot of noise when they are lost. They just fade in and fade out. But Jesus says, thank God that I found that which was lost. Come, everybody, celebrate and rejoice with me, for that which was lost has now been found. Hallelujah, what a message. When Jesus gives parables like that, he's never really just talking about the object. In reality, he's talking about us. We were that lost sheep that Jesus came to rescue us. And we were also that lost coin that God swept diligently around, and he had to remove all of our stuff and all the things that could hide us, and he removes this and moves that, just so we could be found by him. Aren't you glad that we're found by him?
Amen.
Am I the only one in here that once was lost, but now I'm found? When God found me, he found me in the clubs, and he had to move things out of my way just to find me, dusted me off and said, yeah, that which was lost has now been found. Glory to God. Jesus is strategic in his dissertation because he goes from 100 lost to 1, and then he goes from 10 to 1, and then today it's 1 to 1. We'll pick up the text. I'm over in verse 11. And if you'll follow with me, let's see where the Lord is going to lead in this text. Verse 11, are you there?
Yeah.
And then it said, a certain man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth on me. He divided them unto his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered together, all together, and took his journey into a foreign country, and there he wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all there, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would have been weak, or he had a strong desire to fill his belly with the husks that the swine did eat. Look at this. And no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said to himself, how many hired servants in my father's house have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger! I will arise. I will go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he gets up, he arose, and he came to the father. And when he was yet afar off, a great way off, his father saw him, had compassion on him, ran, fell on his neck, and kissed him. Son said unto him, just as he rehearsed, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father wasn't hearing that. The father said to his servants, break forth the best robe, put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and put shoes on his feet, and bring forth the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was lost, dead, but he's alive again. Hallelujah. He was lost and is found, and they begin to make merry. Praise God. What a story. I believe that this prodigal son's story is the crowning jewel of all three. This is the story that I believe really was a conviction for those Pharisees and scribes that were watching, because they knew that they were the ones who had the inherited right of all the Old Testament scriptures. They were the ones who knew that they were supposed to be in right standing with God, but they also knew that they found themselves now not embracing truth, but critiquing the truth that was coming through Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
This story is not about them, it's really about us.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And so, again, when Jesus is teaching in parabole, when he's teaching in parable form, he's really teaching that this story is not really about your faults. It's really about a son, a daughter, who has fallen. A daughter who has made bad mistakes in challenging situations and didn't know what to do. And then all of a sudden, they go and they make their own way. So let me back up just for a minute. What's his story? What is the kind of movie that makes you go back again and again and look at it again and again? I'll tell you. It's a good storyline. It's a good hook. I like movies. Anybody like movies in here other than me? And the kind of movies that I like are movies like Behind Enemy Lines, Mission Impossible, Independence Day. My sons think that I'm a little bit cuckoo because every Independence Day, since Will Smith did it back in the early 90s, I watch Independence Day because I want to make sure that those enemies stay out of our country. Silly me. I know that story in and out. My wife will walk in there and, oh, you're watching it again. But I watch it with them. I mean, I'm in there. I'm the kind of person that you don't want to go to the movies, action movies with, because I get into it. And I know I get it from my grandson. I realize that. We're watching one of his cartoons. I didn't even know this cartoon because my world is so adult and professional, but it is good that he's here because I get to be a kid again. And so the other day he was watching a movie and he got so into it. We got a big screen TV and he was so into it. And he says, "Pop, pop, wait. And so the fight scene was getting ready. I said, "What are you doing?" He says, pause it. And so I paused it and he went in there. He got his Captain America outfit, he got his swords, and he's like, "Okay, yeah." And he's into it. I don't know where I get my movie watching from him. He goes crazy, Carol, and watching. And I said, "Boy, if we hit my screen." But you gotta watch out because he's into it. And like a good movie, and he watches this constant over and over and over again because he's into it. Just like any good story, and I don't know what kind of movies or books that you read, but you gotta get into the story, amen? Every good story has certain key ingredients in it. I'm gonna come back to this story because I don't want this to be just another old prodigal son story. I want you to get into this like me. I want you to know that there's a catchy title, amen. Good story always has a main character that I can relate to. So sometimes I'm Ethan Hunt. And sometimes I gotta go in and I gotta make sure that the plots are there. And I gotta make sure that everybody's in place and everything is done. There are things that are going on in Ethan Hunt's mind that everybody doesn't know about. But there is an evil, dastardly villain who is out there who is going to destroy the world. And my goal, me and Ethan, you didn't see me there, but we were in there. I was the one that helped Ethan to swing around the building over to the other side just to make sure that we could go and crash through the window and destroy and sabotage the evil computers. Y'all don't hear me. I'm telling you the truth. If you look quick enough, you'll see my name on his credits. I'm watching, I'm in there. I was the one that helped make the mask. I'm in the movie. And my wife was looking, "Oh, you're watching again." Yes, I have to help him because he needs my help. Every story has intrigue. Every story has drama. Every story has adversity. There is always an antagonist, a bad guy. Whether you're watching Behind Enemy Lines or Independence Day, there's always a bad guy. But most importantly, there is a conflict that's going to take place. And most importantly, there is an ending that speaks to me. I got to have a good ending. Y'all don't want to say amen. But I've got to have a good ending. If that movie doesn't have a good ending, I will disappoint. And my wife, she will tell you, "I am done with that movie. You picked another bad movie. It was a waste of my time." Because am I the only crazy person? I need to see a good movie with a good ending. And in this story, in all three stories that Jesus is relating, there's a good ending. I am so thankful that the sheep was found.
Yes.
I'm so glad that the coin was found. And today, I'm so glad that the son was found. The Bible says that Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the one who writes the scripts of our lives. Hallelujah. And I believe that in all the cases that when something is lost, don't look at life as though, oh my God, it's lost and it's hopeless. Look at life through the eyes that once was lost, but now is found. I believe that screenwriters don't write the stories of our lives the same way that we see them written as or we view them as they are on a movie. They write the screen from the beginning to the end. And then they build intrigue, drama, suspense, and all of that in between the beginning and the end. And in the end, unbeknownst to us, they know how it is all going to end. And how many of you know that God is the author and the finisher of our faith? How many of you know that He knows how it's all going to end? Even from the beginning. While you're still sitting there eating your popcorn, God already knows how it's going to end. He already knows that as you are going through your life dramas, hallelujah, as you are going through your story, as a matter of fact, can I put it this way? That we are a story. Look at your neighbor and tell him, you are a story. You are a story. You are a story written on the scrolls of God's timing. With this script in mind. So whatever you are going through, realize that there is a beginning, hallelujah, and there is an end. And in the end, God has got your name on it. He's got your blessings. He's got His blessings on it. And whatever you have to go through, you just have to go through whatever it is. So when Ethan Hunt is jumping over buildings and beating up bad guys, and he's going through, I'm in there with him because I've seen it already. I already know, hallelujah. That before that nuclear missile hits Florida, we've already deactivated me and Ethan Hunt. Your story is just like that. What you're going through, and it's really is not my business. All I know is that we all are going through a life story. Are you hearing me today? All of us, Helen, are experiencing what I call a life script, written by the author of our faith, written by the one whose Bible says, my tongue is the pen of a ready writer. He already knows how things are going to work together, according to Romans chapter 8, verse 28. He knows how all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and to those who are called according to His will. He already knows that whatever you are having to go through, you just keep going through, because in the end, I got you. I'm going to bring you through so that way the testimony will be, my God, I got a house, I got my children, I got my nieces and my nephews and all these things, and all things really do. Can I get one witness in here that can testify that really and truly all things really do work together for good to those who love the Lord and those who are called according to His purpose? It's a script. It's a script. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, say, neighbor. It's a script. And somehow, here's the kicker. Somehow, we don't know that what we are going through, how all of this is going to glorify God. We don't know how all of this is going to bring people to the Father. So what Jesus does, D, is He says, I'm telling you all this story in three parts so that when you'll be able to understand, each of you will be able to understand what it's like to be lost, but what it's like to be found. Can I get one witness? And so He saves the best for last. So the first two parables are only just a few verses of Scripture. But when you look at the text, Jesus stops and pauses and takes time to give somewhere around 20, almost 20 verses of Scripture text for this one story. Yes, it's that important. Intrigue, conflict, It involves us taking a, it requires us taking a closer look at this, because everybody is a story. Turn to your neighbor, tell them, say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Everybody is a story. Everybody is a story. Some stories are tragedies. Some stories are comedies. Some stories are mysteries. We're still trying to figure some of you all out. But I believe it is a reason why some people don't allow people to get close to them, because if you really got close to me, you would really discover the real me, and I'm not sure you really don't like that, so it's best that we just keep distant from one another. The outcome of your story is based on your decisions. And so God says, I know the plans that I have for you, saith the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, but plans that will bring you to an expected end. Jeremiah 29:11, you know that. I have decided to live my life according to this motto. Stick to the script.
Yeah.
Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor,
yeah.
stick to the script. If you find your husband getting out of line, Mariah, just tell him, Perry, stick to the script. This is what we got into this for. Because the script tells you how to handle life's challenges. Stick to the script. Here, outtakes. Does anybody know what an outtake is? An outtake is after the movie has already gone, especially if it's a comedy. It is the quirky things that took place while the script was being written. It's the miscues of life. It's the miscommunications. It's, oh man, I forgot my line. Stop and let's go back. But the reality in life is that there are no commercial endorsements. There's no pause button. There's no like, uh-oh, I blew it in January. Stop, rewind, let's go back, and let's rotate. It's not like that anymore. Life is one of those where you say, we got to keep rolling, even with our mistakes, even with our miscues, even when we get off cue, y'all don't want to say amen, even when we get off script, even when we misstep, even when we go to the wrong place, life continues. God, am I right here? And life continues, hallelujah, in spite of the mistakes, and you got to keep rolling, keep rolling, keep rolling the tape, because somehow or another, even with your miscues, even when you get off script, God's got built into the script that even though this mistake happened, I'm still the author, and I'm still writing that in the fullness of time, this thing that you went through is going to be to the glory of God, and you're going to thank God that you went through what you went through, because somehow or another, it will build and feed your testimony. Y'all don't like that.
Amen.
I had no idea, because you know my story. I would love to have been in Virginia or on the East Coast, but God says in His script, stick to the script. I'm sending you to San Angelo. I don't want to be in San Angelo. I'm saying, believe me, in the fullness of time, if you could see back through the annals of time like God would, we wouldn't complain about half as much stuff as we complain about. Somehow or another, He said that I've got a life script for you, that when you move in this place called there, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to increase you. I'm going to add to you. You may not be what you thought you were going to be, but I know the plans I have for you, saith the Lord, and my plan is for you to be in this place at this time, doing thus, and when you do what I'm calling you to do, according to the script of life, you will find yourself blessed, happy, and prosperous. Y'all don't want to say amen to me. I'm talking to anybody in here. But I believe, hallelujah, that we are a story still being written.
Come on, Pastor.
Still being written. And I said, Lord, thank you that you're still writing the script. Thank you that my story is not, he once was lost. End of story. Y'all didn't like that.
Mm-hmm.
This text that I want to share with you for the next 30 minutes or so really is about us. Let's go back. The Bible says over in verse 11 that the man had two sons. He's really talking about the father having two sons. And the younger son, the younger of the two said unto his father, "Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me." We're talking about inheritance. And you would think that the father would know the makeup and the behaviors of the two sons. But thank God that even though he knows us, he still gives us the right and the freedom to make our own mistakes.
Amen.
Y'all didn't like that. Okay. Being a Christian is not about rules and regulations. You have the freedom to do whatever you want to do. I'm just smart enough in these days to make sure that I stick to the script. Because I've tried going off script and look where that landed me. Heartbroken, left, broke, frustrated, and then all of a sudden I came back and I said, "Lord, what's the script?" The script is that even though you went through all these bad times, I'm still going to turn your situations around and to bring you to a right place in me. Y'all So he's got a conflict. And even though Jesus knew that this story was going to touch everybody, he says, "I'm going to make it where everybody would be able to relate. So I really need you to be real with me right now." Can y'all be real with me right now? Here is a man who had a father who was wealthy, provided for him, gave him an inheritance, and he, in his own arrogance and his own self-centeredness, said, "Give me my portion." He's spoiled. Okay, pause. I asked y'all if y'all would get real with me, but y'all won't. So here's the deal. Who in here is the youngest in your family? Spoiled. Y'all want to say it? I'll be the first to admit, spoiled. I got away with stuff that everybody in my family's like, "But Mom, Dad, you let... you didn't do that for us." And my dad would say, "I saved the best for last." "Give me my portion. Give me my inheritance. I know what I want to do with what you have in store for me. So give me my stuff and let me do my thing." And the father does it. He says, "Do you want the inheritance? Here. Here you go." And the son goes off, hallelujah, took his stuff, took his journey into a far country. Somebody said far country. So if you're going to do dirt, don't do dirt here in San Angelo. Go to a far country. Go someplace where nobody knows you, because if you do dirt here in San Angelo, everybody's going to know it. And there, he didn't invest. He wasted his substance on riotous living. He acted crazy and blew all of his money. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Neighbor,
neighbor.
He blew it."
Hebrew.
Now, it's easy for me to critique and criticize this kid because what you did is stupid. You blew it. But is there anybody in here would be willing to admit that there was a time or two where I blew it? I can't knock this kid because he went out to do his thing. He thought he was doing his thing, but he went out and he blew what God had given unto him. And my heart to you, saints of God, is that you will come to your senses and realize that God has blessed you all along. He's been with you all the long. Can I get one witness? He has been there. And so he went in and he began to be in one. There was a famine that came in the land. Yeah, there it is. Thank you. There was a famine that came in the land. In other words, everybody is broke. And he began to be in want. The Bible says that he made a mistake and joined himself. Jesus. In verse 15. He joined himself to a citizen of that country. So you got to be careful with who you hook up with. Hallelujah. You got to be careful who you hang out with. Be careful, because even though you think that you are on the right journey, there will be people who will take advantage of you along the way. Are you hearing me today? And so he's in this situation. He went to the wrong place at the wrong time, and now he's hooking up with the wrong people. And it got to the point where the people didn't care about how much money his father had. It didn't care how much nice things he had. Where you are is right now, Jesus. And you are in this situation. And the only thing I can recommend for you, man, is you might need to go over and with those swine over there and eat what they're eating. Jesus. He's got a situation. It's easy to say what you'll never do until you are faced with that kind of situation and say, oh, I'll never do that. You'd be amazed at what you're doing. See, commentaries say that this boy was a Jew. And for a Jew to eat swine, or eat with swine, was the absolute low point that you could ever get to. One thing that the world does not understand about Christians is that we've all been there too. There might be somebody in here, I'm not going to look at anybody, but there might be somebody here who'll say, I will never say what I will never do, because I'll never know what I will do until I get there. Are y'all okay today? Somebody call his name.
Jesus.
One more time.
Jesus.
Set the atmosphere. Sometimes in life you're going to be in a place, my God, where you're like, how did I wind up here doing this with these people? I must be the only person. I mean, I tried to fit in. I tried to go off script. And when I went off script, I found myself in the wrong place, at the wrong time, around the wrong people, knowing that my Heavenly Father, He's got all of these things for me. Amen. I took what He had. I took the gifts. God, your time, talents, your treasures, your giftings, your anointings, your abilities, your skills. I took all of it and I wasted it. And now I find myself in this place. My God, I can't believe I'm here. I'm back on this park bench all over again, Marcel. Hanging out with the wrong people, doing the wrong thing at the wrong time. Y'all don't want to say anything? Here, y'all. I'm in this relationship again.
Hallelujah.
I can't believe I did it the first time. My God, here I am again. How did I wind up here? Because you spent it, you wasted it, you blew it with other people. Turn to neighbor, say, neighbor, he blew it. Come on, turn to neighbor, tell him, say, neighbor, he blew it, he blew it, he blew it. Wow. The Bible says that he would have fainted. He desired, verse 16, to have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat. And here, no man gave unto him. He didn't have anybody there to help him along the way. See, it's easy when you first start off, maybe, because it seems like, oh man, while you got a lot, you might have a lot of friends. But you let your resources dry up. Y'all right? I'm good as long as you, as long as you pay it, I'm your best friend. But oh, when the well runs dry, people will bail on you. People will bail on you. Then all of a sudden you find yourself, as the scripture says, and no man gave unto them. I want to remind you, Jesus is giving this parable to publicans and sinners and Pharisees and scribes at the same time. Are y'all hearing me? So he is very strategic in who he's talking to and the wording that he is using, because he knows. He knows what they all know but are afraid to admit. He's talking about me.
Yeah.
Myself in a wrong relationship with the wrong person at the wrong time, and I cannot believe I let you back into my life.
Glory. Come on. That's
right. And here we are, going through the same thing all over again,
right.
And I know that there's God has got somebody out there for me, y'all.
Yes. Yes.
I know that there's a better place for, I just know that there is. I know that God has got, I'm not talking to anybody here. I know that there's more in life than what I'm experiencing right now. And God, help me. I got to do something. And when I go and look for some help, nobody is around to help me. Nobody is around. I thought y'all was my friend. I thought you was my girl. I thought you was my homie. Can I say homie in church? But you were my homie, and now nobody's there, and I am by myself eating this with the pigs, the very thing that is God. I am my own criminal. I'm the one who launched the missile. I'm the one who released the virus. I'm the one who went behind enemy lines. And now I want somebody to come rescue me. Somebody, please. Somebody come get me. Oh, Jesus knows exactly the right wording to use, because he could have picked anything, but he said, no. The swine that you detest, that is so against your own culture, your own character, that's the thing that I'm going to use to paint the picture and draw the script to let you know just the depths at what sin will take you to.
Yeah.
Wow. If the story would have ended there, it would have been a tragedy. Hallelujah. But the Bible says in verse 17, when he came to himself.
Come on. Yes. Come on.
Hallelujah.
Lord.
He said to himself,
oh, God,
how many hired servants in my father's house have got it better than where I'm at right now? He came to himself. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, he came to himself. I believe he shook himself. All of a sudden, his reality was not just an illusion anymore. He was really, really in the situation, and he says, my God, I got to do something. And so he shakes him. Can you see him? He shakes himself. He comes to the conclusion, I got to do something about this. Got to do something about how I'm sure. Hallelujah. I got to do something about this. If I don't change where I'm at, if I don't do something right now, I could be in this situation for too long a period of time. The Bible says, there. Somebody say there. You can stay there too long. And so the Bible says that he shook himself, and he begins to relate back. My God, how many hired servants, people who would work for me, have it better than where I am right now, and I am the son, the heir to everything that he has given unto me. See, it's easy to accuse him, but when I look at Ephesians chapter 1, and I realize that the same thing could happen to me.
Yeah.
In other words, in chapter 1, in 1 Corinthians, in 1 Ephesians, it says that he has given unto us, first of all, he has chosen us.
Yeah.
He's predestinated us. He has adopted us.
Yeah.
He's given unto us. He purposed in us. He made known unto us the mystery of his will. He's given everything unto us that pertains to life and godliness, and still many people in church blow.
Yes.
It's easy. It's easy to look at him and go, how stupid could you be, until I look at my own situation. And I go, my God, how could I have blown it? How could I have done this? How could I have ever doubted my heavenly Father? That's why we had to sing songs today to God. Not to encourage you all, but to sing songs to the Father to let you know that, Lord, you are a good, good Father. Not for the lighthearted. This is not for those who have never been through anything. Is there anybody in here, hallelujah, where you've been through some tough situations? Can I get one witness in here? And you've been through some tough situations, and you didn't, and people will look at you and just, how could they ever? I never thought they would ever stoop to that kind of level. Is there anybody in here who's been through some stuff and some adversity and some drama and some intrigue and some conflict all at the same time, not realizing that God is writing a script? My God, He's writing a script. No, I'm trying to let you know that even though you go through adversity, even though you go through drama, even though you go through all of those things, I still have got a script written that in the end, hallelujah, you're going to come out. Am I talking to anybody in here? Can I get somebody to just lift their hands and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for finding me. Thank you, Lord, for me coming to my own. While the slaves, the servants, are doing better than me. I said, Lord, help your people to know we cannot lose our significance. We can't get off script. Am I talking to anybody in here? We can't get off script. Turn to David and say, neighbor, we can't get off script. We got to make sure we are, my God. So he does something that we should all do every time we come into the presence of the Lord. He says to himself, I know what I'm going to do. First thing I'm going to do is I'm getting up out of here. Verse 18 starts off with, I believe, I wish we had a drama team in the church that could do a reenactment of this dynamic. He says, I will arise. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I will arise. No. Forget that neighbor. Find you another neighbor and tell them, say, neighbor, I will arise. I will arise. Find, listen to me. Listen. Would you do me one favor? Would you just stand to your feet, somebody? Would you just go over to your neighbor and would you just tell them, say, neighbor, I will arise. I'm getting up out of here. I'm going to get up. So my grandson Judah, I heard the story this morning, it cracked me up. So my grandson, he knows he should not get the candy.
No.
But he knows where the candy is. So while we're taking naps and he's all on the other room, he goes over, he's got his hand behind his pocket. Gigi says, give me a hug. And so, smart kid, he gives a hug with the other hug. My life is changing. He says, no, give me a hug with the other hand. He goes. Am I telling the truth? See, when you're in trouble, When you know that you know, when you know that you know, you will get smart about how to get out of this situation. No, give me a hug with both hands. And that's what happened. Because I know that the thing in my head,
hallelujah,
it's going to reveal that I did something that I shouldn't have done. So, with tears, no, though, y'all, you got it. I mean, I don't think anybody can generate tears instantaneously. Just somehow or another, he just put on, and tears came out. Goes to his Gigi with arms open. Knows he messed up. And gives her a hug. What we've been trying to teach him since is to tell the truth. Regardless of what you've been through. Are you hearing me today? We just got the candy in hand. The evidence is there. We need to keep him around. He's good sermon material. What do you got in your hands, son? Candy?
Glory.
I'm sorry. I got it. Don't do like he will do. Because he will say, Pop said, I can get your hand when he knows.
No.
He shouldn't have it. I know I mean. He rehearses. He says, okay, I gotta get to my father. When I get to my father, I know how he is. I know what he's gonna do, I know what he's gonna say, so I gotta rehearse it. Everybody can now be there. And he goes, okay, if I say that, no, that's not gonna work. No, that's not gonna work. So we go, okay, I gotta say it. Okay, so okay, when I go to the Father, when I say, Father, I sit before you and before heaven because I know he's a spiritual man, and so if I can tell him, I'm not gonna call, so I gotta go over and I gotta see, this is what we have to do every Sunday. We should be going to the Father. Okay, Lord, I know what I did Friday, I know what I did Saturday, I know what I did Tuesday, I know who I was with, I know what I did, I know what I should do, but I know that you are Heavenly Father, I know that you are grace, I know you know my heart, but you know my flaws, and I know that you know, so I can't just come to God just any old kind of way. I gotta come in a way that he will be able to understand, and he will be able to embrace me. Y'all don't want to see, because you can't come to the Father just any old how. And so he says, okay, I'm going to rehearse it. Okay, I got it. Okay, and so then he gets up out of that mess. And he goes to his father. Now he's on the way back. I'll pause there because while he's going through this mental deliberation, the father, hallelujah, has his son on his mind. And every day the father looks out to the hills. I wonder, how's he doing? Is he going to make it? Lord, don't kill him, Lord. Just make him go to realize that, let him realize that we're here for him. And, okay, it's not today, not next month. But one day the father looks out to the hills. While he's going through this, the father looks up to the hills and he sees his son. And the son is now deliberating his mind. I get to the father, I'm gonna say this, I'm gonna say this, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do this. Can I borrow you, Dick, for just a second? Amen. You be the prodigal son. Amen. And so he's deliberating. You got to act like you're thinking and deliberating. And you're thinking and you're wondering. Amen. And the father is the wondering, where is he? How's he doing? Is he okay? Does anybody have a family member that you are always wondering about how they're doing and will they make it? Does anybody have a wayward nephew or a niece or a cousin that you're wondering, my God, are they ever going to get back on scripts? Are they ever going to, don't they realize their true value and significance? Is there anybody in here that has a loved one who is out there, prodigal, kicking against the pricks and the will of God? Is there anybody in here who has a family member, a friend, who you know is good people, just prodigal? And is there anybody in here, are you the same one that would look out occasionally and go, man, how you doing? How you doing? You send him a text, you send him a son, a brother, a husband, a friend, a co-worker that is out there and go, man, I wonder how they're doing. And then all of a sudden, while they're deliberating, you come and you see them. They don't, The Bible doesn't say the Son saw the Father. The Bible says the Father saw the Son. Because the Father is always looking. He's always looking for us. When are you coming back home? When are you going to get back on your life street? When are you going to get back? Are y'all? When are you coming back home like you were supposed to? When are you going to, when are you going to get yourself together and come back to where you are supposed to be? And then one day the Father looks up and he goes, my Son is coming home. The Bible doesn't say the Father because the Son is still deliberating, Cat. He's still, I got to say this, I got to say this. So I got to be perfect. Some people think, Keisha, some people think that I have to be perfect before I come to church. I got to get, I'm preaching stuff. But I got to get, before I come to church, how many of you have heard this? How many of you have heard this? Before I come to church, I got to get myself together. Not realizing, my God, that you will never get yourself together. I've been saved for over 30 years and I'm still trying to get myself together. I gotta get myself together, but the Bible says, as long as you keep trying, the enemy will always tell you you're not good enough to come to God. You're not good enough to come to God. Can I give it to you the way that the Lord has given it to me? Sometimes the Lord has given it to me, and my stuff is so ragged and tagged. My stuff is so messed up. I just gotta come. I got baggage.
I got issues.
Oh, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, you are the story. I got baggage, I got issues, I got debt, I got family disease. Y'all don't understand. I got issues, I got kids, I gotta drag my stuff. And I'm not perfect when I come to you, but Lord, I can't stay in that situation where I was. And so the Bible says, my God,
Lord,
there's praise on the inside that I can't keep to myself. A holler on the outside that I hope would be a blessing to you all, that you know. You don't have to be perfect to try to come to God. None of us are. But as you are coming, the Father sees you and he's rejoicing and he says, oh my God. And the Bible says that the Father ran to the Son. He ran on him and fell on his neck. Because I am so.
Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son.
But
the Father said to his servants,
I'm not getting that. I want to hear what you have gone through.
Glory.
More important, what you have gone through is that you are here right now. God is not so much interested in all you've been through.
Amen.
What he's more interested in is that you're here right now. Remember, he's talking to sinners and publicans, and he's talking to Pharisees and scribes. What he's trying to tell the Pharisees and scribes is this, is that even though you may think you are found, you're actually lost and blind. You need to do like I'm trying to tell you in the story and tell you that come, that the Father has loved you, and I'm coming to you to let you know that I'm really interested in reconciling us back together again. So, son, I already know what you've been through. Any parent in here, y'all don't have to tell, but any parent will be able to tell their child, I know what you know.
Amen.
Some of us old school guys, we'll be able to say, been there, done that. So you don't need to, one thing I like about Mike Campbell is that we have the ability to talk to the young guys. And they're trying to tell us their story, and we can cut them off and go, okay, let me just save you the details. Let me tell you how the story ends. Let me tell you how the story ends. The story goes like this. You're going through a very rough time. But if you stick with God, in the end, you're going to come out smelling like roses, like you've never been through anything, and your story will be to God's glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so you don't need to spare me the detail, buddy. He told me he loved me, and he told me we were going to get married. He told me he was going to leave his wife and children and their house and be with me. And you were dumb enough to believe that. So let me spare you the details. He's not going to leave his wife and us. The father goes up, falls on kisses him. While all of this is going, she's running out of time. But while all of this is going on, the other brother, Marcel, can I borrow you for a second? While all of this is going on, the older brother is sitting and he's agonizing. It's such a big deal. Oh, that young, I told that knucklehead not to go out there. And now he's out there, he's doing his thing. And now the father is making a big to-do over here. And I've been in church all my life. I never did anything wrong. I'm good. I'm the good son. I'm the oldest son. I'm the elder brother. And he's not making a big to-do over me. We put that on hold right now. It's about the father. The father goes over. Says, man, I'm so glad you're here. Put my robe on. Now this, last time we did this. So don't get it. Don't even look good in. Praise God, don't fit. This is where my sonship students at. This is sonship at its finest. Give you the ring. Give you a kiss. Hug you. Let me put shoes on your feet. Why? Because only slaves walk around barefooted. You are a son of mine. Put on my shoes. Now let's break forth the fatted calf. And let's celebrate. Why? Because that which was lost has now been found. My son has come home. Tell the story to a neighbor, a friend, a relative, that knucklehead nephew, that person who does not want to hear. Let's celebrate and let's make merry. Why? Because that which is lost has now been found. Y'all hear me today? When Jesus is giving messages like this, he's not doing it just so for us to say, oh, that's a good sermon, that's a good story. No, it's a life story. It's a story that says, if you're prodigal, And we've all been there.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
I said, come on, somebody.
Amen.
We've all been there. We've all been prodigal to one degree or another.
Amen.
The reality is that you can always come home to your Father.
Amen.
And the Father is not going to judge you. Right?
Amen.
He's not going to condemn you. You'll be just.
Yes.
Well, let me go back to the Judas story. So Judah knows he can't have the candy. I'll say, Judah, you put that candy back, and there will be no more candy for you for the rest of the day. Got it? Tears. Crying. Put it back. He put it back. No, you took it. You put it back. He puts it back. I'm the Father. You okay? He's crying. I grab him. I hug him. And next thing you know, we're best buds all over again. Just like that. Children have a way of not holding grudges like we adult folks do. Somehow or another, you could make you. He told me one time, Katrina, he says, you are mean, and I'm going to tell Gigi on you. I said, you go ahead and tell Gigi. If you want to, it doesn't matter to me. He went in there and said, Gigi, pop is mean. And he is not my friend. Okay, cool. Within 5 minutes, pop, you know, that's funny. They have a way. Are you hearing me today? This is the kingdom. Because Jesus is trying to tell us, except you come unto me as a child, you shall know why. There's no need in holding grudges. Amen? Just come as a child. Amen? And so, thank you, Marcel. We'll come back to you next week. We embrace the idea that the prodigals have come home. That we're not going to lose script. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you. Put my jacket. Yes. Hallelujah. The idea is that how much time is between verse 15, excuse me, 16 and 17 is clear. It doesn't matter how much time. The Bible, there's a blank spot in my Bible. It's like it just happened in the next day. I don't know how much time it took between verse 16, him finding himself, and verse 17. Verse 17 and verse 18. I don't know how much time it took, but what I do know is this. Is however long it takes for you to go through whatever you've got to go through, God's script has you in line. All things out after the counsel of his own word concerning you. Amen? The Father loves you so much, hallelujah, that he will allow you to go through some things, but you'll never be totally consumed by it. Because he's writing a script. Are you hearing me? He's writing the script of your life. And in the end, we win.